technology in Israel is almost commodity today. But in order to bring a company to success, you need three major things that will happen. One, you need the right team. And I'm not talking about only technological team, you need the whole team on the table. Two, you need the technology itself to be innovative, to be new. And three, you need the money. And we sometimes tell these entrepreneurs that the only thing you can give up from these three is the technology, which is sad, but it's true. And when we tried to build up today those companies and we tell them that the money is the most expensive, it's funny, money is the most expensive asset of them, and they understand today that in order to get a partner that will take them to the next phase, they have to give up all the things that they don't know how to do, which is how to monitor the company, how to bring it to the, how to build the business, and how to focus it, and what market are you aiming to. And since, as I said before, so many of those companies, about 19% of them, never reach maturity, today, when we look at the market and we look at funding, we believe that, and we truly say that, we believe that Startup Nation will die in 2-3 years from now. It won't be the same. So many angels got burned out. So many, you know, in the year 2000, when everything started, you could raise $500,000 of a napkin in the stock exchange in Tel Aviv. You could share a good idea and you would get money. But it doesn't happen today. And less companies are getting funded, and you have, we call it the graveyard that sits in the portfolio of most of the VCs in Israel. Most of those VCs can't raise the next round, and we see one by one those VCs falling down. And if someone won't step into this gap, because we don't have any angels anymore, angels invest 50K, sometimes as low as 20K per company, because they also have some companies in their back that cries for more capital. And we're trying to figure out what will be the next step. So we build new vehicles, and you build it up without the management fee, and you build it up differently, and you try to take small amount of money to bring the company to a product, and you try to do something else. But the capital is something that is lacking Israel right now, worse than everywhere, anywhere. And I think that in 2-3 years, we will have 2,000 companies per year, and more of people that I used to work with are telling us that they gave up. We killed so many technologies in the past 3 years in Israel, not because they didn't have the chance, it's because they didn't have the funding and they have families and they need to support their families, and they go and they find themselves at work as a hired man, and that's it. And I think that's the main problem.
More even.
Well, I have a slightly different view than that. You know, when I was in, when I, my I didn't quite say, I retired from GE in 2002, and then since then I've been venture capital. When I was in GE, I used to go around with a talk that was entitled Innovation is Not Enough. And it was hard to believe, but even I remember a very interesting meeting with the head of the Technion, the president of the Technion, who didn't believe me, who said that no, we can handle it with innovation. The problem is that there is a culture in Israel that says, build it and they will come. And from my point of view, there is a lack of the understanding. It's just like that illustration I talked about, of what is the real need within the domain that you're looking at. I think that was mentioned today. I think Mike talked about it, and other people talked about it today. So I think it's very, very important for Israel to develop two things. One is management. I mean, we have had to replace managers in, I would say, probably 80% of the companies that we've invested in. And the reason is that it's not just build it and they will come. It's not just the technical problem. It's the whole question of even understanding, for example, that a go-to-market strategy is different than a strategy of distribution. If you have something that's new, that is that is somehow or other going to change culture, you have to have very experienced people to who understand even the difference between a marketing strategy or a distribution strategy and a marketing strategy or go-to-market strategy. That's not there yet in Israel. And I think that's the key in Israel that needs to happen. I think Canadians can help in that way in a number of ways. I'm not sure what they all are. One of them I keep harping again and again and again, and that is get a better relationship between Toronto and Jerusalem, for example. And let's learn this how to do this marketing stuff. I think the VCs, the venture capital people, have to change. And this was talked about a little bit by both John and Mike in their session. You need to have a good domain understanding in the VC. They have to understand what is needed. What's the need? The whole concept of, you know, just going out and funding somebody who has a great idea is not going to work anymore. We think, for example, that, and I think Mike certainly talked about it, John talked about it, we think that we need to start with the strategics, the people who are in fact going to eventually either distribute the product or acquire the company or whatever, and understand what is it that they want. If we understand what it is that they want, and then go, instead of having them then go and seek those solutions, then I think you have, as a venture capital company, a much better chance of success. In fact, I think we have a very good chance. We've had one not so successful, but all the rest have been pretty successful. And I think it's because we've been trained, probably within GE, to go and look for solutions to real problems rather than solutions and hoping that they will have a problem. Now, having said that, I have to say this, that the thing that transformed my life was CAT scanning, CT scanning. If you look at CT scanning, that was something that was build it and they will come. Why? Because the people at the Jeffrey Hounsfield, when he developed CT for EMI, was not looking for a solution to a problem that doctors had told him. In fact, you went out and said to doctors, what do you need the most? None of them would have said, I need a CT scanner. I need something that will do that. So you have to be a little bit careful. You can't be as dogmatic as I sounded at the very beginning of the talk. There will be things in which build it and it will come, but frankly, they're going to be few and far between.
Doesn't that speak to a point that perhaps, Mark, you were bringing up with respect to volatility is sort of, yes, build it and they will come, but in today's marketplace, nobody has the risk tolerance to wait for it to get there. They want to see immediate returns on their investments now. And really where I'm trying to go with the question is there still a risk tolerance and an appetite for startup companies, or is it at a point now, or at least for the next while, until things stabilize from a global economic perspective, where the focus is going to be more on mitigating the volatility by going to the companies that you have a sense of, quite frankly, they're a guaranteed return, so the later stage companies.
Yeah.
And what impact is that going to have on startups?
Yeah. I can't speak to the Israeli experience, so I can speak to the U.S. and Canadian experience. I mean, I think the issue with innovation and early stage companies and venture capital is more, to me, is a cultural issue. I think that in Canada, I can say this because I'm Canadians are great bankers, and I think the last 2 years demonstrated that the Canadian banks did not do anything foolish. They stuck to their knitting, and they saved their franchises and all of the mayhem that followed. But I think in terms of, and I don't think anyone, no disrespect, would describe them as innovative businesses. I think it's a different mindset to be a startup entrepreneur, to leave your big company that you're working for, or even leave university and do something on your own. That takes guts. That takes a different kind of person. And I don't think my feeling, Canadians, generally speaking, are predisposed to doing that. You know, doing business in the States, I've worked for a big U.S. technology company in Canada, and doing business now in the States, it's a totally different mindset. American entrepreneurs go for it. Failure is not a bad thing. Failure is a good thing. And, you know, they'll go for it. And there is rubble, and there are consequences. But they're going to swing for the fences. And I think people swinging for the fences leads to innovation, because you're all in, and you're going to find a way to make it work. And they're very resourceful people. I think, you know, I think the role government can play here in terms of public policy is, you know, encouraging risk-taking, encouraging failure, encouraging people to go for it, which I don't think really is part of our culture. And also at the university level or in the academic fields, you know, not, you know, we need to broaden the educational experience to be an entrepreneur and starting up a business and the risks and all the different skill sets you need to do it. So people get thinking about that, and it's encouraged, and it's supported and praised. So I think in Canada that's sort of a cultural challenge we have. Having said all of that, you know, there's a funding problem today. Ray, you talked about it. John's going to talk about it. We have had lots of successes, and in spite of that, we have had lots of successes. But I think, you know, we're at the point now where, you know, we have government being a direct investor in a lot of the VC funds, and I don't think that's where anybody wants to be. That's as a result of the point where so far down the hole that we need this help. We need a tax policy that encourages financial risk taking and innovation, and we also need a public policy that encourages investors to make investments in these funds, so we can find the next great technology company, take a risk, and be rewarded for that. And I just don't think the culture here, one, is supportive of that, and two, sort of the whole infrastructure supports that as well. So I think in Canada, in particular, there are larger issues that are challenging us, in spite of the, not to mention the global economic situation that we're in. I think it's a larger issue.
So you take that question a couple of different ways, Ray. The, if you're running a venture business today, like there's Mars Investment Accelerator Fund, our startups do get funded and they do get a chance to get out of the gate. So it can get better, more can come, but that's not where our gap is. Our gap is sort of from Series A on up in terms of what do you do once you've gotten your $500,000 and you've proven your product or your business out. Where do you go to next? And then when you come back to the venture world, there's less and less of us in venture. And so, you know, if one of the things we have to do to show that we deserve to be in venture is we have to show results. So you now compare the company coming into a Series A round, who has, to Mark, point Mark touched on, you've got a 3 or 4 or 5 year period before you get anywhere with that company. And you also, or you're also faced with, say, a mid to later stage company that's further down the path. And given the market and the economic climate, you can probably get them at a valuation that sort of reflects that Series A financing. So you now get the same percentage ownership that you might get with a later stage company. So the pool of capital drying up forces the investor to make decisions that will give them more nearer term outcomes. So now you're challenging
with
less risk, because you've already got customers out. You know, my sector in Ontario at its peak, we had $3 billion available to invest in venture capital. We're now less than $750 million available, and we just haven't had the take-up. Now, there were good and bad deals done, but still, to get a whole pile of innovation and startup done, you still need the capital pool inertia. Like in 1999, 2000, many of us, if we were at a Nortel or pick an entity where we had a great idea, we might have left our day job to go try and fund our dream, because there was an avenue to the pool of capital. We're more likely stifling the innovation and the entrepreneurship because, unlike the States, we can't necessarily point to, hey, there is that capital pool that will give me that chance.